Mayoral race shows just how questions of equality, class, and socioeconomics can play out in politics. This next story takes an even longer view at social mobility and opportunity and how it's changing the way we raise our children. Economics correspondent Paul Solman has the story, part of our ongoing reporting, Making Sense, which airs every Thursday on the NewsHour.
I am a little strong here, and I'm going to need a little elbow room.
Dave Brickner, currently ranked 31st worldwide in the video golf betting game Golden Tee.
Whoa.
Brickner owns and runs this bar in Port Clinton, Ohio. To supplement his first job doing maintenance on Wendy's restaurants in the northwest part of the state.
I'm working two jobs to make ends meet.
Jim Cornell is a carpenter.
There's only part-time jobs for most people around here.
The haves and have-nots is you're definitely seeing it.
Rust Belt decline, growing inequality. A familiar tale, perhaps, but one getting a new twist from Harvard political scientist Robert Putnam, who grew up in Port Clinton, returned after decades away, and was stunned by what he saw, the death of social mobility. My hometown was, in the 1950s, a passable embodiment of the American dream, he writes in his new book, Our Kids. A place that offered decent opportunity for all the kids in town, whatever their background, including those who lived on the wrong side of the tracks.
The kids who lived here when I was growing up were poor, but they played with all the other kids in town.
Half a century later, however,
the poor kids who live here now are living in a completely different universe from the rest of the kids in town. And that's leading us down the road toward, frankly, a caste society.
Putnam recalls the Port Clinton of his youth as, quote, a pleasant, friendly town of mostly white people, its Lake Erie shorefront dotted with small cottages and modest resorts. The downtown shops thrived on the growing paychecks of the locals, many of whom worked at factories like Standard Products, which provided 1,000 good blue-collar jobs. But then the layoffs began, and Standard Products was down to fewer than 500 jobs in the 1970s, closed in the 90s. It's now a hazardous waste site.
Standard Products, they closed down, I worked there. Silgan Plastics, they closed, I worked there like 9 years.
Today, Robert Snively gets by on seasonal landscaping work with jobless benefits and food stamps in the winter, supplemented by visits to the St. Vincent de Paul food pantry. Ann Heckard managed to retire from her factory job before her plant shut down. Now runs this food distribution center for those on unemployment insurance and disability.
We have 100 to 115 families every 2 weeks, usually more at the end of the month. The jobs just aren't there.
Neither is the pay. The average worker in Ottawa County, where Port Clinton is located, earns 16% less in inflation-adjusted dollars than his or her counterpart in the early 1970s. In the last decade alone, child poverty in Port Clinton has quadrupled from 10% to nearly 40%. And those are averages in a city where you pass trailer parks on the way to luxury developments of multi-million dollar homes.
We're in the Catawba Cliffs. It's a private community on Lake Erie.
Chris Galvin is head of the local United Way.
But it's still all the same zip code. 43452 is Port Clinton.
This was not a high-rent district when I was growing up, but of course now in the last 25 years, this has been taken over by huge mansions all along here. You can see in the parking lot of the Port Clinton High School, BMWs that are driven to school by kids who live out here.
In Robert Putnam's day, everyone hung out together at Tony's Snack Bar, now the a la carte. The future was bright for the members of the class of 59, regardless of their socioeconomic background, be they the rich Ray Lambert, known as Casey, or Virginia Park, who was poor.
I grew up on a farm and I was one of 10 children. So our economic status would have been much lower than Casey's and probably considerably lower than Bob's as well.
But you didn't feel that difference?
No, not much. I didn't know until I was a senior in high school that his family were the wealthiest people in Port Clinton.
News to me, I didn't know that.
But you knew you were better off than other kids?
No. And I got the same allowance as all my friends.
And when you're thinking about somebody like Ginny, You don't even know how much money she has or doesn't have?
No, it's not important. Why would it matter?
Those economic things, I know it sounds crazy nowadays, but those economic things were not at all visible to us kids.
But your parents both had graduate degrees, right?
My dad had a graduate degree. My mom got a college degree while we were in high school.
My parents both had an education that ended in their sophomore years in high school.
Ginny Park won a scholarship to college, has held an elected county office for 25 years here. Her rise, says Putnam, is typical of his classmates.
80% of the kids in my class here went beyond their parents' education. So this was a period of enormous upward mobility here in Port Clinton.
Now, if you're wondering why we're suddenly in a bowling alley, it's because of a famous article Bob Putnam wrote 20 years ago, later turned into a book, Bowling Alone. That's Putnam and his eighth grade team on the back cover, racially, socially, economically diverse.
Bowling is big in America. More Americans bowl than vote, so it's a big deal. But but bowling in leagues, bowling in teams, declined by about 80% over those ensuing years. And what that was a symbol of was the fact that we were no longer connecting with other people the way once we did.
And that loss of community, or what he calls social capital, says Putnam, is both a cause and a consequence of today's growing economic divide.
America is silently, but really importantly, becoming increasingly segregated by how much you earn and how much education you have.
Putnam is careful not to sugarcoat the 1950s.
There were serious problems of racism and of sexism and homophobia, of course. But the American dream sort of existed here. That is, the chance that everybody would do better than their parents and poor kids would not be disadvantaged.
And today, what would happen?
Well, it's no longer the American dream. It's a split-screen nightmare because kids who are coming from well-off backgrounds, well-educated backgrounds, like my grandchildren, are doing better and better. They're doing better in school. They're more likely to take part in extracurricular activities. They have higher test scores. Whereas kids coming from lower, less educated homes are doing worse and worse.
As a final illustration, Putnam and the United Way's Chris Galvin had put us in touch with two of those poor kids. One, a young man, canceled our 5 p.m. appointment because he got a snow plowing job. He rescheduled for the following morning, but failed to show. The other, a young single mother, was supposed to bring her children to this art event, organized in part to bring rich and poor kids together. She too was a no-show. It's a problem Bob Putnam faced while doing research nationwide for the book.
The poor kids often stood us up. And what we began to realize is that's their life. They don't have cars, so they're dependent upon public transportation. If the buses don't run, they can't get there. If the boss calls at the last minute and says you've got to work an extra shift, they've got to work an extra shift so they can't go there.
And so, says Putnam, the chaos of poverty feeds on itself. And today's poor, unlike those of Port Clinton in the 1950s, and of pretty much every other place in America, are increasingly out of sight, out of mind, and out of luck.
I missed it.
This is economics correspondent Paul Solman, reporting for the PBS NewsHour from Port Clinton, Ohio.